this is the International Commission that the two churches, the Orthodox Church and the Anglican Communion, the Anglican churches have established. It's a commission for dialogue, theological dialogue. And His Eminence is the Orthodox co-chairman of this dialogue. And then we're here for this purpose. And we were blessed to invite him to come earlier. And he has given lectures since Thursday, Friday, and today. So, Your Eminence, many people here are people who have read your books. Some of them have become Orthodox because of your books. But we're really excited and blessed to have the class. Last night, Your Eminence talked about the Jesus Prayer, and this morning he talked to us about Divine Liturgy.
Speaking of the liturgy. This is the final mystery, and beyond this it is not possible to go, nor can anything be added to it. And a great priest of the early 20th century in Russia, St. John of Kronstadt, says, the Eucharist is a continual miracle. So I invite you this morning to reflect with me on the inner meaning of this final mystery, of this continual miracle. Let us renew our sense of wonder before the mystery of the Eucharist. Plato says, the beginning of truth is to feel a sense of wonder. So then, although we know the liturgy very well, let us cleanse the doors of our perception and reawaken our feeling of wonder. Now, there is a Chinese question. What would you do if you were emperor, supreme over the earth? With complete authority? And the answer to the question is, I would make people use words with precision and accuracy. So let's start this morning by thinking about the word liturgy. Literally, it means the work of the people. Ergon dulahu, liturgia. And a liturgy is something that can only be done by many people in common. It is a shared, corporate action, something that we can only do together. That's the meaning of the word liturgy in ancient classical Greek, pre-Christian times. And we can apply it to the Eucharist. If the Eucharist is termed liturgy, then this signifies that at the service there are no passive spectators, only active participants. The laity do not hear the liturgy, but they do it together with the clergy. And so we find that throughout the course of the service, the plural is used. We do not, in the Eucharist, with very few exceptions, use the word I or me. All through the service, we say we or us, emphasizing that we are not acting alone, but in solidarity with one another. And this is particularly clear in the epiclesis, the invocation of the Holy Spirit on the gifts of bread and wine, which forms the high point in the service. There the priest says, "We pray, we beseech, and we implore you," he's addressing God, "send down your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts here set forth." We pray, not I pray. Send down the Holy Spirit on us, not just on me. And the same emphasis upon our solidarity together is very apparent in the Lord's Prayer, which follows shortly after the epiclesis. We do not say my Father, we say our Father. We do not say give me today my daily bread, but give us today our daily bread. Everything in the Lord's Prayer is plural, we, our, us. Nowhere do we say I, me, or mine. That's a story I like to repeat, an all-purpose anecdote that I take from Dostoevsky's masterwork, The Brothers Karamazov. There, Dostoevsky has included a folk story he heard in a village about an old woman and an onion. Probably you know it already, but I shall repeat it all the same. Once there was an old woman, very devout, strict in her fasting, making many prostrations to the ground. She died. And to her surprise, she woke up to find herself in a lake of fire. Looking out, she saw her guardian angel walking on the bank. So she called out, "There has been some mistake. I am a very respectable old lady. I should not be here in this lake of fire." "Oh," said the angel, "do you remember a time when you were kind to somebody else?" The old woman thought for quite a time, and she said, "Yes, once I was gardening and a beggar came by, and I gave her an onion." "Excellent," said the angel. "I happen to have that very onion with me now." And he reached into his robes, and he produced it. And she took the other end of the onion, and he began to pull her out. But she was not the only person in the lake of fire. And when the others saw what was happening, they gathered round her and hung on in the hope of being pulled out as well. This did not please the old woman at all. She began to kick and to shout, "Let go, let go. It's not you who's being pulled out, it's me. It's not your onion, it's mine." And when she said, "It's mine," the onion snapped in two, and she fell back into the lake of fire. And there, so I'm told, she still is. That is Dostoevsky's story. And now I will add my own comment. What a pity the old woman, instead of saying, it's my onion. What a pity she didn't say, it's our onion. If she'd only said that, perhaps the onion would have been strong enough to pull them all out of the lake of fire. But when she said, it's mine, not yours, she was denying her essential humanness. Because to be truly human is to be in relationship with others. And she was being unliturgical, because the liturgical word is not me but us, not mine but ours. So then, thinking of the old woman and the onion, let us note how it's only very occasionally in the liturgy that we say I, and there are special reasons where that occurs. Now there is a threefold moment in the liturgy which most people do not notice, but which underlines the fact that the liturgy is something that we do together in union and solidarity with others. When the priest comes into the church, before he puts on his vestments, he says the preliminary prayers in front of the icon screen. And then before entering the sanctuary, he turns towards the west and he bows. Usually, nobody has arrived yet at the church, so it's only the angels who are there to bow back. Then, later on in the service, before the great entrance, during the singing of the hymn of the cherubim, the priest once more turns to the people and bows. And by this time, yes, there are quite a few people there. And they bow back. Then he goes to the side chapel, and in procession he brings out the bread and wine that have been prepared. Then there is a third time when the priest bows towards the people. And that is just before he receives Holy Communion. Very often you don't see that because the doors of the icon screen are closed and the curtain is drawn across. But during Eastertide, yes, when it is open, you will see how the priest bows once more and the people bow back. Now, what is the meaning of this threefold exchange of bows? Is it just external courtesy, the priest acknowledging the presence of the people, glad to see you here, and the people responding by bowing back, yes, we're pleased to be here? No, it has a deeper meaning. When the priest bows to the people, he says in his heart, or perhaps aloud, forgive me. And when the people bow back, they say in their hearts, or perhaps aloud, God will forgive. So there is in the liturgy, at these three moments, a repeated threefold exchange of mutual forgiveness. We cannot, in a genuine way, celebrate the liturgy in union with one another unless we ask each other's forgiveness. Christ says exactly the same when you come to the temple with your gift. And if you then remember that you have something against your brother or sister, lay aside your gift, go and be reconciled, and then return to church, to the temple, and offer your gift. That applies to the liturgy. Without mutual forgiveness, without mutual love between the members of the congregation, there cannot be a true celebration of the holy mysteries. Only if we come before God as a reconciled people, can we truly share in the sacrament of unity, the body and blood of the Savior. Then let us recall other moments in the liturgy which underline our union, our mutual love. Before the creed we say, let us love one another, that with one mind we may confess, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Trinity, one in essence, and undivided. So there cannot be a true proclamation of faith in God the Holy Trinity unless there is mutual love. Or again, think of the dialogue that comes just before the great prayer of consecration, the anaphora. The priest says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people respond, and with your spirit. Let us lift up our hearts, says the priest. And the people respond, we lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord, the priest says, which could also be translated, let us celebrate the Eucharist, Ευχαριστήσομεν το Κύριο. And the people respond, it is meet and right so to do. Now, what is the meaning of this dialogue? First, the priest blesses the people, and the people respond by blessing him. And then the priest says, let us lift up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord. And the people respond, yes, we lift up our hearts. We are giving thanks. Now, in this dialogue, says St. John Chrysostom, the priest is, as it were, asking permission from the people to continue with the celebration of the service. The priest, says St. John Chrysostom, cannot make the offering alone. He can only truly offer the Eucharist if the people are sharing with him in this act of offering. And that is the meaning of this dialogue. The priest invites the people to join with him in what he is to do. And only when the people have expressed their consent and agreement, only when they say, axion ke dikion, it is meet and right so to do, only then can the priest continue. Because the Eucharist is not his alone. It has to be the shared action, the common offering of the total people of God. And another word that particularly underlines the solidarity of priests and people in the Eucharist is a word that we use frequently, but we do not reflect on its meaning. It is the word Amen, the Hebrew word that means so be it. Every time the priest offers a prayer to God, the people seal his action by saying Amen. And that word Amen that we use in such a casual manner has a dynamic and profound meaning. The people are saying, so be it. We affirm what you have said. We make your prayer our own. We are one with you as we stand before God. So, in all these ways, you can see how the liturgy forms a single unity, priest and people together performing one shared action. Now, let's consider what happens just at the beginning of the service, before the opening. Blessing. the priest celebrant raises his hands to heaven in the ancient gesture of prayer. And he says, glory be to God on high, and on earth peace. Now, what is the meaning of that? It underlines the fact that the liturgy is taking place on two levels. There is the liturgy in heaven, the celestial celebration, at which Christ is the high priest, and in which the Holy Mother of God, the angels and the saints join. That is the glory on high. And then there is the earthly service, celebrated outwardly by the visible priest, expressed in the words, peace on earth. Glory on high, peace on earth. Now that phrase underlines that the liturgy is taking place on two levels at once, in heaven and on earth. More exactly, we, the visible congregation, the priest and the people, during the liturgy, we are taken up into an action far greater than ourselves. We are taken up into the worship of heaven. We become part of the celestial liturgy in the heavenly places. There is one liturgy on earth and in heaven. This is often expressed in the phrase used to describe the liturgy. The liturgy is an earthly heaven. The church at prayer is heaven on earth. Edigios uranos. So at the very outset of the liturgy, it is underlined that we are doing the same thing together with the celestial hosts. We can say there is one liturgy on heaven and earth, one celebrant, Christ himself, because the true celebrant at every divine liturgy that we attend is Christ. With the eye of faith, we should see standing before the holy table, not just the priest, but we should see Christ himself, the one unique high priest of the new covenant. A single liturgy in heaven and on earth. We are taken up into an action far greater than ourselves. Christ himself is present in the midst of us wherever the liturgy is offered. And that is made clear in a sentence said by the deacon to the priest before the initial blessing. And usually that's only said in a low voice so the people don't hear it, which is a pity. The deacon, when he sees that everything is ready for the start of the service, says to the celebrant, not it's time for us to begin, but it is time for the Lord to act. Now that tells us many things about the true nature of the divine liturgy. The liturgy is not just words, it is an action. And considered in its true depth, the liturgy is not our action, it is the action of Christ himself. As the priest says in the prayer joining the hymn of the cherubim, you are the one who offers and the one who is offered. And as the clergy say before the creed when they exchange the kiss of peace, Christ is in our midst. So there it is very clearly underlined that the true celebrant, the real priest, at the liturgy is Christ. And we, the congregation, as we pray, are called always to remember the living, immediate presence of Christ, the true celebrant at the liturgy. Now, all that I've been saying about the liturgy as heaven on earth is revealed in the story of the conversion of Russia. You may remember how Prince Vladimir of Kiev, not yet a Christian, sent out his messengers to the different parts of the world, wishing to discover what was the true faith. They went, for example, to the Muslims, but when they heard that the Muslims didn't drink alcohol, they said, "Ah, that will never do to the Russians." And so they moved on to the city of Constantinople, and there the Greeks took them to the celebration of the Divine Liturgy. And when they returned to Vladimir, they said of their service in the Church of the Holy Wisdom, "We did not know whether we were in heaven or on earth, for surely there is no such beauty anywhere on earth, only in heaven." "Their service," he says, referring to the Orthodox service, "surpasses in beauty the worship of all the other nations, and we know that God is present with them." So exactly the experience that the Russian envoys received, the experience which converted them to Christianity, was this sense that the Divine Liturgy is heaven on earth. And this is a theme that keeps coming back in the Divine Liturgy. It is underlined at the two entries, the little entrance, the procession with the Gospel book in the first part of the service, and then the great entrance, the procession with the holy gifts of bread and wine at the time of the singing of the hymn of the cherubim. Now, when the priest processes through the church with the Gospel book at the little entrance, he says the prayer, "Make with us an entrance of your holy angels, worshipping with us, and together with us celebrating the liturgy." Unfortunately, usually the people don't hear this prayer, because that is the true meaning of the entrance with the Gospel, that we are celebrating together with the holy angels, that as the priest enters the sanctuary with the Gospel book, the holy angels are accompanying him, because the holy angels are our concelebrants at the Divine Liturgy. So there at the little entrance exactly, we reflect on the nature of the liturgy as heaven on earth. There is an incident in the life of the great Russian state saint Seraphim of Sarov which illustrates this. When he was deacon in the monastery, one Holy Thursday, at the little entrance, the entrance of the priest with the Gospel book, he saw Christ himself coming in through the doors of the church and moving through the center of the church, surrounded by a great host of angels, like a swarm of bees, said St. Seraphim. And then Christ entered the sanctuary. So there St. Seraphim saw with his very eyes what usually takes place invisibly. the entrance of Christ together with our entrance. He was so overwhelmed by this vision that for a number of hours he could not speak. But this happens every time we celebrate the Holy Liturgy. Indeed, at that moment, Christ himself is entering the church and the holy angels, the saints, with him. And then again, the unity of heaven and earth is underlined in the great entrance, in the hymn of the cherubim. Ita cherubim mystikos ikonizontes, we say in Greek. And that is usually translated, we who mystically represent the cherubim. But actually the Greek is stronger and more specific. It does not just say represent, but it says are icons of the cherubim. Ikonizontes. The true translation then would be we who in this mystery are icons of the cherubim. Now an icon is not just a representation. And this is why the word represent is inadequate. It's rather colorless. A representation of something is just a likeness. And it need not have any living connection with the original whom it represents. But an icon is more than just a holy picture. An icon performs a mediating function. The icon of Christ makes Christ present immediately to us. The icon makes things present, does not just act as a visual reminder, but it acts as a point of meeting, a place of encounter. Equally, if we stand before the icon of the Transfiguration in prayer, through the icon we enter into the mystery of the Transfiguration. It is as if we ourselves were present on that table and looking on Christ in glory. So an icon makes things present. If we say that we are icons of the cherubim, that means we are united with them. We are participating in what they are doing. The worship of the cherubim in heaven is to be united with our worship on earth. We are being taken up into what they do. So the true translation of the hymn of the cherubim, we are icons of the cherubim, exactly underlines once more that the liturgy is heaven on earth, that the heavenly powers, the cherubim, the seraphim, the angels, the saints, the Mother of God, Christ himself, all are immediately present in this celebration of the liturgy. So the meaning of the hymn of the cherubim is, you are not alone. You have invisible companions. You have innumerable worshippers. Our prayer may be weak and faltering, but their prayer is firm and strong. And as we enter into their prayer, our prayer too can be strengthened. So those are some reflections, so much more could be said, some reflections on the inner meaning of the Divine Liturgy. And I began with some words of St. John of Kronstadt, the Eucharist is a continual miracle. Let me end with some words from the same holy saint. And St. John of Kronstadt loved the Divine Liturgy. He used to celebrate every day. Here he writes, in the words take, eat, drink. There is contained the abyss of God's love for humankind. O perfect love, O all-embracing love, O irresistible love, what shall we give to God in gratitude for this love? Thank you.
Can't, for medical reasons, eat any bread.
and so I could give her the communion in the spoon, but without the bread. So we have to allow for the fact that the divine and the human interact. The Eucharist is a continual miracle. The bread becomes the true body and blood of Christ, but it is also material elements received by human beings. So the divine and the human interact. And therefore we do the best we can with communion. And if people have great difficulty in swallowing, then we would give them the smallest portion of the Holy Blood, just a tiny drop. Because the whole Christ is present in every part of the consecrated sacrament, however small. What do we do if there are accidents? And of course, accidents do happen. We take the utmost care, but sometimes the sacrament may be spilt. In that case, we try to make things right in the best possible way. But we should not, I think, be too much upset by accidents. If Christ has the power to make bread and wine into his body and blood, then if part of the sacrament is spilled, Christ has the power to protect that and put it right. The sacrament was given for eating and drinking. If something happens which makes it impossible for it to be eaten or drunk, then it ceases to be the sacrament. So, if something is spilt, we tidy things up in the best possible way, but we do not think an act of blasphemy has been performed against Christ. Quite simply, the elements that are spilled, because they are no longer able to be eaten and drunk by the faithful, they cease to be the sacrament and simply revert into the world of matter. Does that answer your question?
Well, I was also wondering if there would be an unexpected interruption of the divine liturgy and something happening in the nave, must the celebrants continue the liturgy to its conclusion?
Yes, they should. They should restore order and go on with the service. And so we keep the best possible order during the service, but we always remember the liturgy is more than this group of people. The liturgy involves the total church in heaven and on earth. And so the action of the liturgy should continue, even if there is some inappropriate interruption. We restore order, and then we continue.
Thank you.
Yes, please, from behind there.
This question brings up another issue, which is the interruption of liturgies in history due to war. In Greece, people believe that the liturgy that has been interrupted due to invasion will at some point continue, recommence from where it stopped. And there is, in fact, I learned this from a parishioner who is not here today. When the Bulgarians invaded the Serbian part of Greece in the Balkan Wars, the liturgy was interrupted. Then many years later, the same church was liberated, and the same priest and parishioners who were still alive went there and started the liturgy from where it has stopped. The most famous myth about this, and I don't know if it's a myth, but is of course the conquest of Hagia Sophia by the Turks, where a liturgy was allegedly interrupted. And there is a whole mythology about how it will recommence and all that. Is there any theological basis for this?
The way I would understand the story that you recall from the sack of Constantinople in 1453 about the interrupted liturgy in St. Sophia and how the priest will come out again and complete the liturgy when St. Sophia is made into a church once more. Yes, I think the point lying behind this is that all particular celebrations of the Eucharist are part of the one heavenly celebration. The Eucharist is celebrated in many different places on earth, in many different languages. But in the end, there is only one Eucharist. There is only one Christ. The one Christ is present at every liturgy. And the one Christ is the true celebrant at each liturgy. So every liturgy is a part of the one fundamental Eucharistic self-offering of Christ himself. So if particular celebrations of the liturgy are interrupted for whatever reason, yet the single heavenly divine liturgy continues without interruption. The interruption happens only on the level of earthly celebration. It does not impinge upon the unity and completeness of the liturgy in heaven. Yes, some cases one might try to continue the liturgy where it had been interrupted. But even if it is not resumed, the interrupted liturgy is still taken up into the heavenly liturgy, which is never interrupted. Now, hands going up. Back, yes, please.
Yes, sir. A little bit different topic, but you mentioned during the cherubic hymn how we are icons of the cherubim, in fact. And it sounded good at first, but as I think about it, that sounds more troubling. Logos didn't become non corporeal being, he became anthropon. And are we not icons of God?
Sorry, I didn't quite understand.
Well, about us at the liturgy being icons of the cherubim.
Yes.
Are we not icons of God, in fact, not of the non-corporeal beings?
Yes, we can use the language of iconography in many different ways. First of all, we may think that Christ is the icon of God the Father, Colossians 1:15. Then we may think that we humans are in the are icons of God. We are here according to the image and likeness of God. And that can be understood in at least two ways. We are icons of Christ. Christ is the Logos. We humans are then our logiki, endowed with spiritual understanding. Though we are also icons of the Holy Trinity, that's another way of understanding the icon in the human person. And then, of course, we have the painted icons in church, wood and paint, theology in color. That's another form of icon. So there are many different levels of iconography. And my point with regard to the hymn of the cherubim was simply that if we are icons of the cherubim, that means we are doing on earth what the cherubim are doing in heaven, that we are taken up into their action. I wasn't applying the word icon necessarily in any further sense, but simply understanding it in that way. Yes, please.
Your Eminence, a practical question. Having grown up as a Roman Catholic in the days of pre-Vatican days when the Roman Catholic Mass was in Latin, and having grown up in an Italian parish, it was the Hall St. Anthony's actually, when the liturgy was celebrated in Latin, my Italian ancestors would say, "Oh, we understand this, it's so beautiful." And of course, they understood Ave Maria, Pater Noster, and that was all the extent of it. My question to you is the Orthodox Church worldwide, so many of the ethnic groups, no matter where they are celebrating in tongues like ancient Slavonic or ancient Greek, that the masses really don't understand. What is your reaction or approach to this problem as you encounter other ethnic groups beyond the English-speaking world? Because the liturgy seems to get lost from the point of view of the masses understanding exactly what you have magnificently shared with us today.
Yes. In principle, we in the Orthodox Church celebrate the Divine Liturgy in the language of the people. And that principle was established very clearly in the 9th century with the mission of Cyril and Methodios to the Slav countries. Cyril and Methodios translated the scriptures and the liturgy into the language of the people, into Slavonic. They did not insist on the use of Greek. So at that time in the West, the German missionaries in the lands newly converted would have used Latin, not the language of the people. But in the East, we use the language of the people. But what has happened is this. We Orthodox are very conservative. We are traditionalists. And so today, in many situations, we are celebrating the liturgy not in the language of people today, but in an archaic form. And the question then arises, how far is this archaic form understood by the people? So in the Greek church, we have the use not of modern Greek in the liturgy, but of Byzantine, or rather New Testament Greek. How far is this understood by the people? I get different answers when I ask that question. And of course in the Russian church, they are using Church Slavonic, which I think is more difficult for Russians today to understand than is the liturgical Greek for Greek people. So there is a tendency to use the language of the people, but in an archaic form. And the question arises, for example, should the Russians celebrate the liturgy not in Slavonic, but in modern Russian? In Greek it is more difficult because naturally we are happy to hear the scriptures read in the original language, the New Testament Greek. And so that's a strong factor for keeping the older form of Greek. But I do see a real problem that these ancient forms of language are understood less and less. In my own parish in Oxford, the Russians who had come out from Russia, who had been baptized as adults, and these were highly educated people, university professors and the like, they said to me, the first time we really understood the liturgy was when we heard it celebrated in English. Because they said, yes, the Church Slavonic is very beautiful, moving, but we don't really know what it means. So I think the answer has to be in the Western world that we should gradually more and more introduce the use of English in the services, but of course keeping Slavonic and Greek where that is wanted by the people. But for most of us, English is now our language, and there are translations of the liturgy which are dignified and beautiful, and we can use those in English. People who know the original language will say the English, it doesn't convey the same meaning and depth. All right, no translation can fully render the original, but let us celebrate the liturgy in a language that people understand, so it can be truly a shared action. Now, let's take a question from over here, yes.
I'm a convert, and before I got cremated, some of my Orthodox brother jokingly asked, can you take the inauguration of the liturgy. So my question is, what is the origins and the reasons for the lengthy duration of the liturgy?
For myself, I do not feel the liturgy is too long. I'm sorry, but it's true.
You need a hierarchical liturgy.
But, of course, some people vote with their feet and only come for the later part of the liturgy. My Cypriot parishioners in Oxford don't ask me, when does the liturgy start? They ask, when does the liturgy end? However, if you celebrate the liturgy in a straightforward way, without unduly elaborate singing, you can perform the liturgy in an hour and a quarter. Or a weekday liturgy, you could even do it in an hour. So we shouldn't exaggerate the length of time that the liturgy takes. I think that once we start saying the liturgy is too long for people and shorten it by leaving things out, we are on a slippery slope. If people say an hour and a quarter is too long, it must be 1 hour, then once we reduce it to 1 hour, they'll say it must be 45 minutes, and so we go down. If it is difficult for some people to attend a service lasting an hour and a quarter, well, they can come late. And they do. But for myself, I would not favor any drastic simplification and reduction of the liturgy. Indeed, I am in favor of saying the priest's prayers aloud in the hearing of the people, and that even makes it a little bit longer. But the true theology of the service is exactly in the prayers of the priest. And it's a great pity if the people don't hear that. And particularly the epiclesis, the invocation of the Holy Spirit, people don't realize what is going on if everything is said silently or in a low voice, not in the hearing of the people. So yes, don't let's draw the liturgy out too long with unnecessary notices about tea parties, but let us keep the liturgy within reasonable limits, but let's not shorten it too much. Why should we be in such a hurry? Now, another question, please.
The other week, my Cypriot church in Niagara Falls was closed, so I had to go to other Orthodox church. And I just happened to be in the Coptic church in St. Catharines. And their service was much longer. And it was very moving. Our service is getting shorter and shorter, as you know. So if you can comment a little bit, what is going on today with the development of liturgy? Why is it getting shorter?
Well, if I was to give a simple answer, I would say people find the liturgy too long because of their lack of faith. And if we had a deeper faith and warmer love for Christ, we would not mind spending a bit of time with him in the Divine Liturgy. I find the example you give from the Copts very striking, because when I've been to Coptic services, I have noticed how the people participate, yes, and how there is a real sense of fervor throughout the congregation. Yes. So they are in some ways an example to us.
Yes.
We celebrate the liturgy in our somewhat different way. We share the same faith with the Copts. Alas, we don't have Eucharistic communion yet with them, but we pray that this will happen before too long. I don't see any real obstacle to us sharing with them in the sacraments. But let us try to keep something of the fervor that the Copts had. I think it is because we have become dominated by a secular spirit that we keep looking at our watches for the time and saying the service is taking too long. If we had greater faith, we should rejoice to be with Christ in the liturgy. However, I don't think we should draw the service out too much. People's sense of time varies. I remember the advice I was given by my spiritual father, who was a Russian priest, about preaching sermons. And he imagined that the congregation would be standing. When you are preaching, he said, if they start shuffling their feet, don't worry, just go on. If they start looking at their watches, don't worry, just go on. But if they look again at their watch and shake the watch to see if they're going to stop, then perhaps you'd better stop. Yes.
I've been told that the little entrance, when the priest enters with the Gospels being the Word of God, that that's a symbol of Christ coming among his people. Is that something that you agree with?
That is an interpretation with which I also am familiar. There are many different ways of interpreting the liturgy, and they do not exclude one another. There isn't any one form of interpretation. And one way of looking at the liturgy is to see it as an unfolding drama covering the life of Christ. And there are various schemes by which different moments in the liturgy are linked with different events in the life of Christ. And these different schemes don't necessarily exclude one another. They can all help us to see a deeper meaning in the liturgy. So the little entrance with the Gospel book, while it is understood in the text of the service as the angels entering the church because of the priest saying the prayer, make with our entry an entry of holy angels, it can also be interpreted symbolically as the Word of God being preached to the people. So some schemes understand that as Christ going out among the people, preaching the Word of God. And then the great entrance is understood as Christ entering Jerusalem on Palm Sunday before his Passion. And so it continues with different interpretations of the different moments of the service. And these interpretations are not essential, but if they help you to understand the liturgy better, that is quite all right. One could look at the liturgy in a very functional way and say, there are two high points in the liturgy. The reading of the Gospel, that is the high point in the first part of the service, which is a service of praise and scripture readings. And then you have the consecration of the holy elements and the act of communion, which is the high point in the second part of the service. And in each part of the service you have a procession in which you bring to the holy table the things that you are going to use in the high point that follows. So in the first part of the service you carry the Gospel book in procession because you are shortly going to read the Gospel. And in the second part of the service, you bring the bread and wine to the holy table because shortly afterwards they are to be consecrated and used for communion. So you can look at the processions in this way, in a functional way, but you could also have a symbolical interpretation if that helps. Right, over here.
If you could please comment on what we can do in our parishes. What can we do in our parishes to involve people and make our liturgy, in fact, the work of the people? You know, certain people are going to sing, certain people are going to read, but that's going to leave some people out. Yes. What can we do to involve everybody?
Yes. That is a real problem. In very many of our Orthodox churches, the people don't seem to play any great part. Now, the first thing would be, let us revive, where it doesn't exist, frequent communion. The supreme way in which the people share the liturgy, all of us, is by receiving communion. I can remember when I was first Orthodox, in many of our churches, virtually nobody came for communion. People used to go to communion only three times a year, or perhaps only once a year. So the priest would come out and say, with fear of God, with faith and love, draw near, and sometimes nobody would draw near except a few babies and small children. Now, fortunately, that has changed in very many of our churches. In my lifetime, I have seen a revival of frequent communion. I am not in favor of casual communion. We should always prepare before we receive the Holy Sacrament. We shouldn't just go automatically. But surely it is a happy thing when at the Divine Liturgy, not just at a great feast, but on an ordinary Sunday, large numbers of people come up to receive the sacrament. So that to me would be the first way in which we express our participation in a common action. But there are other ways of this happening. For example, in the Slav churches, when you arrive in the church, you can buy one or two little loaves, and you send the loaves up to the sanctuary with the list of the persons who are going to be prayed for. And the priest will cut out a fragment from each loaf, and that will eventually be placed in the Holy Chalice. And so by this act of sending up loaves with our own personal intercessions, then that's another way that people can be involved. I know that in the Greek tradition, there is just the one large Eucharistic loaf, and certainly in Greek villages, even today, that loaf would be baked at home by the family, and one or more families would take responsibility to provide the loaf. And of course that happens in a modified form in our Greek parishes abroad. Though people often buy the loaf from a baker rather than making it themselves. Well, that act of sending up the bread, feeling that the bread of the Eucharist is bread that I have baked and that I have offered, that also can underline our unity together. I'm in favor of the practice in Greek churches at the little entrance and the great entrance, when the celebrant goes right round the church in procession. In the Slav churches, they just come out of one door and go on to the solaire and back into the sanctuary, and they don't go right round the church. But I find this circling movement of the celebrant going right round helps to gather the people in. Could we not have more congregational singing? In some Orthodox churches, Greek and Russian, I and Romanian, I've found that there are various points in the service when the people all sing together. And that I find very moving. There can be other parts where the choir, the more complicated parts, do the singing. But we shouldn't let the choir monopolize things. Choir masters tend to be tyrants. We shouldn't So I would like to see much more congregational singing in our churches. And when that happens, I do feel a real solidarity among all the people. Now, Father Christoph, if he's here, will tell us whether the time's come and when we should stop. I think we've gone on quite a long time.
I have a very small question.
All right, let's just keep it off.
And I really enjoyed your talk this morning. Have you written anything more extensive about it that would you recommend that we read?
I've not written a book about the liturgy. I have written articles which are scattered about in rather obscure places in periodicals. I'm planning to gather together my articles and to publish them in a single volume. I did have a plan to have a series of volumes with my articles gathered together, and one volume came out called The Inner Kingdom. That happened in the year 2000, and I'm afraid to say I haven't got around to getting on with the other volumes. I've been too busy with other tasks.
Yeah.
So I do plan to gather together my articles on the liturgy, but you must be patient. In a year if I refrain from coming to Buffalo and giving talks, stay quietly at home, then perhaps this will happen. But I do plan to gather things together, and I'm also writing a book which is two-thirds written but needs revising. This is a more scholarly book, but I hope it might be interesting to some people, on the meaning of the liturgy as sacrifice. We say that the liturgy is a sacrifice, a mystical sacrifice, without shedding of blood. But what do we mean by sacrifice? And there were debates about this in 12th century Constantinople. So wait a year or two, and perhaps all will be revealed to
you. Thank you, Reverend.